Okay, so I've done the lighthouse for you and showed you how to do the beams of light. I hope that helped you. Don't forget to contact me, give me feedback, and let me know how that worked for you. And I'm also going to remind you is join my Facebook group, Adult Coloring with ILene Vick, so you can post some of the results that you've gotten and ask me questions. And I'm going to remind you also that don't forget that I do private videos there that I don't launch on YouTube. Okay, so let me position my book here. That's the one we're going to be working on, the blank one, of course. No, let's just color over the one that's already colored. And this is called ILene Being Silly, because she feels good. Okay, so let me show you what colors I am going to be using for the moon. First, I'll be using Faber-Castell Cream number 102. I'll show you these colors in a minute. I'm also going to be using Derwent Yellow Ochre number 050. That'll be on the moon itself, of course. Then I'm going to be using Faber-Castell. Let's get that little number, 268, which is the green gold. And this, of all things, is a Crayola. It's a Crayola watercolor pencil, some cheapy pencils that I got at Walmart, and it's just called brown. I've always kind of had issues with Faber-Castell getting like a true brown, so this guy has always worked for me. I really like it. Alright, so let me color this color so you can see it. And then the brown. Okay, Faber-Castell 102. Derwent, which I'm going to say just DW. 050. Faber-Castell 268, Crayola, called brown. So let me just show you these colors here. Take a look at those for a minute. Okay. Don't forget that I was inspired on the moon from this book that I did. By the way, notice how I did the transparent fin on her, which is The Mermaids by Selena Fenish. That was a technique that I taught in a previous video, how to do that, to make those fin tails look transparent. Alright, so first thing I'm going to do now is I want to start with my lightest yellow. And what's going to happen ultimately, guys, is that ship is going to be done in black because you have a huge moon there in the background from this little ship. Let me show you a sample. Doesn't that look cool? See? So you've got this big, huge moon and the ship in front of it. So of course your eyes are going to tend to adjust to the light and you'll just see the black ship. I thought that would look really neat. Alright. So I'm going to get my cream and let's color in some moonscape. Mm-hmm. love how this cream looks. It's got a really nice pale yellow. Now, don't press hard because it's a light color, because you want the yellow to be light. So don't push the pencil color just because you think that you need to see more of it. Now, I'm not going to use video time to color this whole moon background, but I am going to color around the lens, one of the landscape features, so I can show you what I want you to do with that. And then once I show you the technique, you can finish it yourself. Now, one of the things that you can do with this yellow, which will make your piece look really interesting, is if you want to darken it a little bit inside of a curvature, you can. And you can darken it around the outside of your landmass or crater. So in other words, your yellow is going to be a little bit darker around the borders than it is in between each feature. And that'll make your land masses look interesting. So once you color around your particular land mass, and in this case I'm doing this guy here, then we go back and we darken the edge towards the landmass, or towards the crater, if you want to call it that. And it's a very subtle change, but that's what makes it look neat. And when you color, don't try and keep up with me as far as how rapidly I'm moving, because remember, I've done this several times actually. So if you need to take your time a little bit more, especially see these little dots around the dolphin. I would prefer, if you can help it, to not color over them, but color in between them. Two, one. See these little dots in between by the dolphin here? By the dolphin? I would prefer that you color in between them and not just over them. No big deal if you do color over them, but it just makes it nicer for when you go to add your second color, especially if you end up doing your dots in pencil. You're not layering another pencil color on top of pencil. Now, if you use a gel pen, for example, to highlight that water, it doesn't make a difference. But if I don't, if I use pencil, because I've left those dots clear, it will look better. And that's just little details that I like to do in my coloring. Sharpen here. Notice how I'm coloring in little small circles, especially near the edges of my craters. Yeah. Okay, now I'm going to go back and I'm going to go ahead and darken with my same yellow pencil around the outside. And yes, it does show up. I don't think you're going to be able to see it in video, but I can see the difference. Let me pop you in a little closer and see if we can get that for you. Look carefully, you'll see it. See, it's darker right here and lighter right here. It really does make for a nice effect. You can see right where that halo is of darker color. And again, remember, always let your pencil do the work. Don't bear down on it so much that you create a ridge in your paper. Just keep going over it several times until you achieve the darkness that you want, the shade that you want. And keep that technique in mind for other coloring that you do, of outlining something in the same color but a little bit darker. Because remember, what I'm teaching you can be used in other applications. That's the whole point. Yeah, that looks really cool with that darker halo of color around it. And see, that's what's going to make people admire your pieces, because as they're looking at it, all of a sudden they're going to notice that there's a shade difference. They're going to go, wow, that's a neat technique. And then feel free to go over it as many times as you want until your outlining color or halo color is the shade that you want it to be. And I'm probably pressing on a scale from 1 to 10, probably 4 or 5. Only because it's a lighter yellow shade. If I were using a blue, for example, it would probably be, maybe a 2 to a 3. Okay. Next color I'm going to use now is my Derwent 050. I'll show you my little reference chart. Okay, so now I'm going to take my Derwent and very, very lightly and in circles, I'm going to color, my landmass. Now, be careful about sticking in one place too long, because as you do, it's going to get darker. And you really do want to try and get an even color here. So once you decide on a light shade, in other words, I'm not going to keep going back, you know, and coloring this and coloring that and coloring this, because it's going to darken. I want a nice, even, consistent shade. Be sure that you get to your edges also. And if you have derwents, because they're soft, you know you don't need to press on them very hard. By the way, I just noticed something here. I need to grab my eraser. I didn't get the pencil erased around that when I drew that landmass. Excuse me the interruption, but I wanted to fix it while I thought of it. Okay, so I've got my base color down, which is the lightest of the three, and now I'm going to use my blender pencil, which I've cleaned off on another piece of paper. You guys know I get after you about that, is always clean it off just before you use it. Smooth that. Yeah, you can really see where I've blended and where I haven't blended. Be sure to get out to your edges again. And when you go to do the rest of these land masses, which again I'm not going to do on camera, the technique is exactly the same. All right. Okay, so now I am going to use my Faber-Castell 268, which is my green gold. And I'm going to start building up the color around the edges. And what I'm doing is I'm doing small circles. And the reason that I'm doing that is because land masses or islands or, you know, in this case, the craters are not necessarily uniform in color, right? So as I do this in circles, see how you can see it's a little darker here and a little darker here. It just makes for a nice spreading of the color. You don't want it so uniform that it looks artificial, right? And as you move inward, lighten up the pressure of your pencil. So I'm pressing maybe a 2 or a 3 on the outside. And as I come in a little bit, I lighten up to about a 1. Okay? And I'm coming in half an inch maybe, but don't forget to leave a center section of your lighter color. You'll see this as I go along. And this is where the understanding of going over an area 2 or 3 times really is important to understand, because as I do that, it changes subtly, it changes the colors along the outside. So I may stick in this spot for a minute and let that get darker, and then I'll move on. Okay, and I'm just going to come in just a little bit. Don't forget to turn your pencil, keep it sharp. Doesn't that look great? See the little flaws of color? I don't know if they're flaws, but the variances of color there. It's just naturally happening with this pencil. Because if I hover in one spot, it makes it a little darker, see? Whereas if I go to another spot, I might not stay as long. I'm just staying around the edge. See? Now obviously where this bottleneck's here, you're gonna, it colors in the whole thing, and that's fine. Maybe allow that to get a little darker right there. Now, as some of you have noticed, this is an Albright Durer pencil, which is the watercolor version of Faber-Castell. I bought these by mistake, so the colors are the same, but they just react a little different, because if I were to put water on that, it would distribute the color. So if there's any question about that, again, I just meant to buy the polychromos, and I bought these by mistake. They're a little more tackier. They stick against the paper. I can feel it. Okay, so now I've got that outlined. I've got this much being light, this being light. Just for visual interest, I'm just going to hit some spots here with this. Going to let that whole peninsula go dark. Going to darken this little bit where this bottleneck's. Play with it. I really want you to experiment on your own, because if you keep doing exactly what I'm doing, you're not going to learn the technique and get your confidence. So maybe copy me halfway around, but then strike out on your own and, you know, vary the distance coming in a little bit. So instead of your white area being this whole thing, maybe you just close it down a little bit. That's cool. Okay, I'm happy with that. I'm happy, so happy. Okay, now I'm going to take my Crayola Brown, purchased at Walmart, very inexpensive pencils. Now watch. I have a very sharp point. You pull you in. And what you want to do now is make a very narrow outline. Remember when I did the octopus in Lost Ocean that was sitting in the middle of the page and we outlined that and it really made it pop up? That's what we're doing here. And just like the previous color that I put down, if you want to bring in the brown just a little bit, put it right on top of that last color, but be lighter with it, okay? See how I'm doing that? Yeah. So you want a very dark line around the outside edge, and then you want to bring your brown in a little bit by reducing the pressure when you color in. You can do it in little circles also. See how that's picking up beautifully? Yeah. So see, there's my darkest brown right there. There's the same brown right here. And here's my medium brown, right? That was my lightest brown, medium, dark. And then the pale yellow, or the yellow that I did the first color. Not the yellow, but the lightest brown. So my technique on a lot of things has been to outline with the darker color and using the same pencil by decreasing the pressure coming in a little bit, and that's what creates your edges. And your effect of at having, you know, depth. Again, don't forget to rotate. See how I'm putting this dark brown right on top of the medium brown? And here's the lightest color, the light brown. I'm just calling them all brown for now. And with my darkest brown, I'm not covering up all of the medium brown. I'm probably half of it, maybe. And if it covers it all of it once in a while, like right here, so what? You don't want it super perfect or else it's going to look contrived. Doesn't that look neat? And I suppose it would be helpful for me to pull the camera out where I'm coloring. Sorry. But same technique, see? Now, I've got a little area here that's a curvature. And, you know, I did my really dark line on the outside. Now I'm going to bring it in a little bit lightly as a curve. See? To give that a little depth, like it's a landmass. And again, let your pencil do the work. Just keep stroking it until you like how the color looks. Now, in this case, my darkest brown is covering the medium brown completely until I get to my light center. That's okay. That's what makes an interesting landmass. And I'm going to make another color here. See how I'm pulling that in? To give it depth and making it look interesting. Yeah, see how that looks? So practice that technique as well, please. In other words, I could do it right here as well. Look for areas that you can do that on. See? I'm going to get my previous gold here and fix that. That looks a little artificial here. Just want to smooth that out a little bit. Yeah. Move you around just a little bit. And where this squeezes together, I'm going to allow the darkest brown to completely cross over just for interest. See? And then other places I'm sticking right near the edge. Now see, I've got a little curvy right here. I can either choose to stick near the edge or I can go ahead and do my little inward coloring, your choice. Oh, that looks neat. Now, remember how I also told you to take one last look at stuff to make sure that you don't have any awkward things going on? I see an awkward thing. See this line right here? It just looks straight. So I want to fix that. I'm going to use my lightest. Let's see here. I'm going to use my lightest color, which is my yellow ochre. And I'm going to blend over that color just to change that transition a little bit. It was too abrupt. Oh, much better. Mm-hmm. And if I still want to fix it a little bit, I will take my blender pencil, clean it off. And particularly work on that transition spot. Much better. In fact, if you want to go all the way around and do that, give it a little bit of a hit. It's going to smooth everything out. Look really good. There you go. Moonscape. All right, now let me show you one little thing. You want to do the same thing with your small areas. But what I'm also going to do, I'm taking my darkest brown because I've got this little line here, and I'm going to go over the top lightly. See how I'm doing that? And then when I go ahead and do my land mass, it'll pick it up. And I've got a couple of mountains over here. We can do the same thing. And I really can't do that right now because I don't have my yellow colored in. It's stopped right here. So just go ahead and touch it with your darkest brown. And that way you'll get a nice contrast. And when you go ahead and do these craters, take your lightest color, of not the moon color, not the yellow, but take your lightest color, which is your yellow ochre, and go ahead and we can do that center part right there. But I'm going to go ahead and do it a little bit darker. In other words, it won't be as light. Let me back you out. It won't be as light as this area here. It's going to be a little darker because it is, in effect, a hole, and the moonscape was pushed up. So this yellow ochre is going to be darker than what we did over here as the base color. And then you can go ahead and do the rest of this like I just showed you. And I'm letting that go pretty dark. Now, remember, I used my three browns here to do the larger landmass. But since this is smaller, and remember, you've got this landmass here. So, instead of using the three colors, you might want to use just the green gold. Let me go ahead and do that for you so that you know what I'm talking about. And do the green gold right here. And I'm going to do that a little bit darker. Because again, this is on top of this landmass, which you need to do just like I showed you. Keep your pencil sharp for these areas because they're narrow. Yeah, it's looking pretty sweet. And this is why I love my little Tombro, because I can get in those tight areas. I really would suggest that you get one if you don't have one. Okay. So now you know how to do that. So let me pull out completely so you can get a whole idea what's going on with this moonscape. Let me move a couple things. And I'll put one above the other. Alright. So there's the one that we're working on with the moon shifted to the left. This is the one where I put the moon in the center next to the lighthouse at the ship. But you can see now what this overall effect is going to be looking like, especially with that lighter, the pale yellow, the cream. Yeah, the cream color, Faber-Castell, and how sweet that whole thing is starting to look. Okay, make sure we got that lit for you. Yeah. Okay, looking good. All right, so go ahead and finish your land masses. Do not do anything with the ship. Just get all your craters done, get your moon background done. And next time I go to film, I will have it done and I'll show you how to do the sky. All right? Okay, guys, I hope that helped. I hope you enjoyed doing this as much as I enjoyed coloring with you. And thank you so much for spending your time. This is ILene Vick for Adult Coloring with me. ILene Vick, have a great evening and God bless. Until next time, bye.